Your textbook used the topic of ozone depletion to demonstrate how science works. Thus, in addition to understanding what science is and how it works, you should also have an understanding of ozone depletion. I'm not going to reiterate the entire textbook discussion here, so be sure you have carefully read the textbook. At a minimum, you should be able to answer the following questions. The most complicated question is likely number 7, so I will elaborate on that here. But first, a little background on our atmosphere and radiation. Our Earth's atmosphere can be divided up into different layers, which we see here. Almost every topic that we discuss in our class will be related to the lowest layer, the troposphere. Later in the class, we'll talk about air pollution and climate change. Both of these topics deal with the troposphere. The only time we will discuss the stratosphere is this week, when we discuss stratospheric ozone depletion. There is ozone, which is 3 oxygen atoms bonded together, in both of these layers. But the sources and the impacts of this ozone are quite different. In the troposphere, ozone is an anthropogenic pollutant. When we have poor air quality here locally in the Bay Area and have officials spare the air days, tropospheric ozone is usually the culprit. It's created by a photochemical reaction with car exhaust and other air pollution, and it damages your lungs. Stratospheric ozone, on the other hand, is naturally created, and it protects us from damaging UVB radiation. This Environmental Protection Agency poster shows this clearly. Tropospheric ozone is bad. It damages our lungs. So bad nearby. Stratospheric ozone is beneficial. It blocks ultraviolet radiation. So ozone is good up high. Now let's be clear. In the troposphere, the stratosphere, and even the mesosphere, the most common gas is nitrogen, followed by oxygen, followed by argon. All the other gases we talk about, ozone, sulfur dioxide, carbon monoxide, etc., occur in just trace amounts. But within the stratosphere, there's slightly more ozone than in other parts of our atmosphere. We'll talk about why in a few minutes. This area of the stratosphere, in fact, is commonly called the ozone layer. You can see it depicted here in infographic 2.1. Now, technically, it's not a layer, but it's simply a region of the stratosphere with a higher concentration of ozone gas. You can see from the diagram what those ozone molecules do for us. They effectively block ultraviolet B, or UVB, radiation from reaching the Earth, thus protecting us from this damaging radiation. Let's backtrack a bit. Solar energy comes to us in the form of electromagnetic waves. There are several different types of radiation emitted by the sun, and they are named by their wavelength. The wavelength is the distance from the crest of one wave to the crest of the next. You can see the different names on the diagram of the electromagnetic spectrum. The visible spectrum are the wavelengths that we are able to see, and they range from 0.4 micrometers to 0.7 micrometers. 1 micrometer is 1/1000th of a millimeter. And ultraviolet waves are even shorter wavelengths. UVA is the one closest to the violet. UVB is in the middle of ultraviolet wavelengths, and UVC is the shortest and most damaging of the ultraviolet radiation. So up here in the stratosphere, ozone molecules are blocking some UVA and a whole lot of UVB from hitting the Earth, thus protecting us from damaging radiation. So why does this ozone exist in the stratosphere? Ozone is naturally created when UVC waves hit a naturally occurring oxygen molecule and break it apart into two oxygen atoms. Oxygen atoms then are very reactive, and they bond with another oxygen molecule to form O3, ozone. Notice that during this process, the O2 molecule actually absorbs the damaging UVC, thus preventing it from moving further through the atmosphere and eventually reaching the Earth. Ozone is also naturally destroyed. When UVB and UVC radiation hit ozone molecules, they break them apart back into oxygen atoms and O2 molecules. And this radiation has essentially been blocked from reaching the Earth. So during the natural creation and destruction of ozone, these natural processes are blocking harmful radiation from reaching the Earth. Pretty cool. A great system in perfect balance. Until we humans started creating and releasing CFCs, chlorofluorocarbons. These molecules contain chlorine, fluorine, and carbon. Thus, we call them chlorofluorocarbons, CFCs. Notably, CFCs are completely anthropogenic. We've created many types of CFCs, and none of them exist naturally. So these CFCs were awesome. They could be used as solvents, as aerosol propellants, as refrigerants, as propellants for making styrofoam, and more. And the cool thing was they were seemingly safe, non-reactive, and non-toxic. Until they float up into the stratosphere. In the stratosphere, they encounter a whole lot more UV radiation, and they get broken apart and become much more reactive. Now check this out. Follow along on this excellent diagram. When exposed to UVB radiation, CFCs break down. Specifically, chlorine atoms are released. Notably, chlorine is highly reactive and is able to attack an ozone molecule and break it down into molecular oxygen and chlorine monoxide. Notably, these molecules are not toxic. Rather, the problem is that an ozone molecule has been destroyed. But the problem does not stop there. Free oxygen molecules present in the stratosphere break the oxygen off of the chlorine monoxide, creating an oxygen molecule, O2, and a free chlorine atom. Now this chlorine atom is free to go and break down yet another ozone molecule. This process continues over and over, and it's estimated that one chlorine atom can destroy up to 100,000 ozone molecules before it makes its way up into the mesosphere. Yikes. Before moving on to the next part of this video, I encourage you to pause the video and work your way through this diagram again on your own. And here's infographic 2.5 from your textbook, denoting the same process. Again, I encourage you to pause the video and you work your way through the diagram. This thinning of stratospheric ozone happens everywhere, but it is most apparent over the Antarctic and to a lesser extent over the Arctic due to something called the circumpolar vortex. The circumpolar vortex is pretty much what it says, circumpolar vortex. It's an area around the pole where the air gets trapped. Basically, in the southern hemisphere winter, the cold air is isolated from the rest of the air moving around the Earth. And you end up with very, very cold air over Antarctica. This cold air, of course, has ice crystals within the clouds, and these ice crystals effectively absorb some of the chlorine from the CFCs. So you have a bunch of chlorine absorbed onto these ice particles. And in the springtime, when all those ice particles melt because of increased sunlight, all of a sudden there's a release of a whole bunch of chlorine atoms, and you have a rapid destruction of ozone in that region. Eventually, later in the spring and into the summer, this air that's depleted of ozone gets mixed more thoroughly around the whole Earth system, resulting in a thinning of ozone everywhere. You have this same process occurring in the Arctic in the Northern Hemisphere winters as well. But in the Northern Hemisphere, there's many land masses up in the far northern regions, which disrupt the air movement in such a way that you don't end up with the same isolation of cold air right above the North Pole. Lastly, I just want to stress 3 points. First, stratospheric ozone depletion is the topic of Chapter 2. It's this ozone that's naturally occurring in the stratosphere that blocks ultraviolet radiation from reaching the Earth. Tropospheric ozone is something that we're going to talk about later in the course. Tropospheric ozone is an anthropogenic pollutant that damages our lungs. Also, if you'd like more information on ozone depletion, you can check out the Environmental Protection Agency's website. I've given the link here. Lastly, and very importantly, we haven't talked about climate change yet, but I want to drive home the point now that stratospheric ozone depletion does not cause climate change or global warming. Again, stratospheric ozone depletion does not cause global warming. It's tempting to think that that extra ultraviolet radiation is somehow warming our atmosphere, but that's not the case. Okay, we're going to talk about the connections between climate change and ozone depletion later in the course, but for now, just hold on to the fact that stratospheric ozone depletion is not the cause of global warming.